Hello, and today's presentation is about using surveys in your church. So in this presentation we're going to talk about why you would want to use a survey, how to design survey questions, how to design a survey, and that is a separate issue from designing the survey questions themselves, and how to interpret the results of your survey. So let's look at why would you want to use a survey. The purpose of using a survey is to answer one or more questions, usually regarding affirming a current activity that your church is involved in or identifying new opportunities. Typically you want to use a survey to ask, is what we're doing needed? I've worked with a lot of nonprofits and even at for-profit corporations where you ask somebody, why are we doing this? Or why are we doing this way? And the response is always, well, that's the way we've always done it. The purpose or rationale for some activity oftentimes gets lost in the history of an organization. So a survey can help you ascertain, is what you're doing still needed? And if it is still needed, are we doing it well? Is there a better way to approach this problem or a different way to approach it? And then also, it can also help identify, is there anything else that we need to be doing? Is there some other activity that maybe we need to do in addition to this, or to support this activity, or in companion with this activity? Or sometimes, is there something else that we need to do instead of this activity? So these are the kinds of things that a survey can help you determine. So what a survey does, because you can do research, depending upon what the topic or question is you're trying to answer, sometimes you can find that information by looking at surveys that have been done of other congregations. But what a survey does is it gives you information about your specific congregation in your specific community. For instance, you might read a report that says 73% of churches are using Facebook. So you might conclude, well, we need to use Facebook because 73% of churches are doing that. But if you survey your own church, you might find out that Facebook isn't the right tool, or maybe social media isn't even in the right approach for your congregation or in doing outreach to your community. So that's what a survey does, is it tells you something specific about your church in your community rather than just national or regional trends. Something else a survey does is it ensures that questions are asked in a consistent manner, because you might have a question and let's say you're the senior pastor and you enlist a couple elders or deacons or some staff members and you ask people about a certain topic. Well, those people might ask different questions, or they might ask the same question in different ways, or sometimes even a different order can produce different results. So using a survey rather than an informal polling of people by talking to them one-on-one guarantees that the questions are asked in a consistent manner and in a consistent order. The other thing that doing a survey does for you rather than an informal poll like talking to people is that when you do a survey, it gives you both a population and sample size, and those are statistical terms. The population is basically the number of surveys that you give out. How big is the population that you're looking at? And the sample size is basically the responses that you get back. What are the, so if you pass out 300 surveys, that's your population, assuming you pass one survey out to everybody that's available. And if you get 150 back, 150 is your sample size. And we'll talk more about population and sample size later. Now let's look at how you design survey questions, because you want to make sure you ask the right questions and you ask them the right way so you get the correct results. The most important thing in determining how you word your questions is looking at what is it that we need to learn? Why are we doing this survey? What is the problem that we're either trying to fix or the opportunity that we're trying to identify? And you need to keep that in the forefront in everything you do in your survey. What is the information we're trying to get out of the survey? Because when you put together a survey, there's a lot of questions you could ask, but you don't want to ask all of them. You want to ask just enough questions to get the right information that you're looking for. And it is important to design questions very carefully. If you don't word the questions correctly, that can render your results meaningless, and we'll get into a little bit later how to word questions. Now, in terms of question formulating the questions, the simpler you make the question to understand and respond to, the more likely you are to get answers. And that's why binary answers or questions with binary answers are the best. And by that I mean questions that have yes, no, true, false, black, white, up, down answers. These are the easiest for people usually to understand, and they're oftentimes the simplest to answer because it's just either circle one of these or write in yes or no or whatever the response is. Now, related to binary questions, which have two options, a scaled question gives people, you ask one question and you simply basically ask them to rate their response. And oftentimes you see this as a rating of 1 to 10, with 1 is worst, 10 is best. I suggest to people when they do surveys, instead of doing 1 to 10, instead use 1 to 3 or 1 to 5, and I'll explain. When you use a rating of 1 to 10, if you ask people what is the difference between a 7 and an 8, they can tell you that an 8's better than a 7, but they can't tell you why. It's more difficult to quantify. And the same thing if you ask them what's the difference between a 3 and a 4. Or if you ask them, what is the difference between a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you can break that down to 1 is strongly disagree, 2 is disagree, 3 is no opinion, 4 is agree, and 5 is strongly agree. You can easily quantify what each one of those numbers mean. And I just use that as an example. You can come up with other ratings, but with 1 to 5, your 1 and your 5 are extremes, your 2 and your 4 are tending toward the extreme but not quite all the way, and then your 3, your answer in the middle is no opinion or really doesn't make a difference. And you can simplify that even using a 1 to 3 scale, where 1 is disagree, 2 is no opinion, 3 is agree. I like to use 1 to 5 because I like to differentiate between where somebody feels strongly about something, whether it's strongly agree or disagree, or whether they just simply have an opinion, which is agree or disagree. So that's why I highly recommend using the 1 to 5 or the 1 to 3, but definitely not the 1 to 10. And make sure that when you use these scales, don't assume people always think that 1 is the worst and 5 is the best. Make sure you spell it out, which one is which. And then, you want to keep your essay answers to a minimum because essays take longer for people to fill out, but you want to make sure that you use essays when they're necessary. And let me show you an example here. You could ask a question, should we start a new community outreach? Well, if you ask people simply yes or no, you'll get the opinion that, what we should do, but you won't get an understanding of what it is they think we should do or why we shouldn't do something. So this is a good opportunity for an essay question. So you can say something like, list 3 ways you think we should reach out to serve our community. So therefore, you not only get, an affirmation that we should do some kind of new community outreach, but also what kind of outreach, people think that we should do. And then make sure, going the extra mile with this question is that, list 3 ways you think we should reach out to serve our community. You could also add to that, or write none if you don't think we should add any new outreaches to the current suite of outreaches that we're offering to our community. Or something a little, sorry, I'm thinking off the top of my head here, but you get the idea that you want to make sure that you don't force people into listing 3 ways they should reach out to the community if they think that what you're doing is already fine. So you want to make sure you give them that option in the question to explain that, they think that we don't need to do anything else. But this is an example of where an essay question serves you much better than a binary or a multiple choice or a rating type answer. And you want to make sure you keep questions as consistently worded as possible. And by that, I'll get into that a little bit later by making sure they're positively worded. Other things we want to make sure is we avoid jargon or technical terms. Now, often when we say technical terms, people immediately think computers and electronics. But a technical term is any term that you use in your ministry that other people wouldn't necessarily use in everyday speech. Your music ministry has technical terminology. Your children's ministry has technical terminology. So every ministry has its own language, and you want to make sure that if you're asking questions about a specific ministry, that you explain your terms so everybody understands what it is that you're asking them. We also want to make sure we avoid double negatives. This keeps your wording simple and it keeps things positive. The most common example I see of double negatives is something like, would you vote to avoid a prohibition against? Okay, if you stop and think through that phrase, you can immediately see the layers that you have to go through of sorting information to figure out what that question is actually asking you. Would you vote to avoid a prohibition against? More simply put, would you vote to support? much simpler, it's positive, it's easier to understand. So try to avoid the double negatives. And then make sure, you know, you provide not applicable answers where appropriate. There are some things you definitely want people to, either say that that they have an opinion about this, that they need to make a choice, we have to vote yes or no on this, you can't say not applicable. But there's also a lot of instances where, you know, it's okay if people don't have an opinion about something. So it's, anyway, just want to make sure that you think through that you provide not applicable answers where appropriate. Avoid double-barreled questions. Now, double-barreled questions, this is different from a double negative. A double-barreled question is where you're asking two things at the same time. For example, in the question, would you like to see coffee served in the lobby and bagels in the fellowship hall? Well, you're asking about two different types of food, first off, and then even if you were to combine them, you're asking about food and location in the same question. So it's more complicated for people to answer that. Because they may want to vote the yes about one thing but no about the other, and they're not sure what they should say because you've mixed up the two questions. So we can separate this out. Would you like to see coffee served in the lobby? Would you like to see bagels served in the fellowship hall? Make that two different questions. That way we can figure out whether people want stuff in the lobby or fellowship hall. But again, we still have double-barreled questions because we're mixing food and location. So it would be simpler, to have a couple multiple choice questions here. Number one, where would you like to see coffee, bagel, water, soda, donuts served? And they can check off all the ones they'd like to see served. And would you like to see food served in the lobby, sanctuary, fellowship hall, wherever else? So people can check off, and we'll get into cross-tab analysis later, but even then there's some variations. But at least you're separating out food in one section and location in another, and you're giving people the option for multiple choices, unless you put in the question, check only one. So we're not going to serve food in all of these locations. You got to pick one location where we're going to put food. Now, in putting together your questions, again, I just want to emphasize it's important when you're doing your survey, brainstorm your questions first. Don't try to filter them with all this double barrel, double negative, biased language kind of thing. Just get your questions up on a whiteboard or on a sheet of paper or a computer screen, wherever it is you're working, brainstorm all your questions first, then go back through and check for these things to make sure that you don't have the double-barreled, double-negative questions, biased language, and that you've made the questions worded as simply as possible. And most importantly, we want to avoid bias. Bias is any time that you put language in that would try to change the person's frame of reference about how they answer a question. And usually you can avoid bias by avoiding adjectives. For instance, do you want to serve coffee in our lobby versus do you want to serve coffee in our brilliantly lit, beautifully designed and decorated lobby that has brand new carpet? Okay, by putting all those extra adjectives in there, you've biased people against a certain answer. So again, just keep it to the facts, try to avoid the adjectives. And I do want to emphasize, it is difficult to be objective, and that's why after you put your survey together, it's a good idea to have somebody who's not involved in the survey, someone outside your church, someone outside a particular ministry, have them read the survey to see if there's any bias in it, because objective eyes can give you a great perspective. And again, like I said, get your questions, brainstorm them first, check for the bias and all these other things, and then go back one last time to make sure the questions you're asking, will they help you get information about the question that you're trying to answer? Because in your brainstorming, you may have come up with some really good questions that might be appropriate for a different survey, but not for this particular survey. And then you also want to make sure you get complete answers, and by that, you might, and you're putting together your question, or putting together your survey, you might come up with a question that gives you a bit of information, but you need to think the next step beyond that. For example, in a survey that we did last year about children's ministry curriculum, we asked churches, what upper elementary curriculum do you use for your weekend ministries to children? And with that, we would get a list of all the curriculum that churches are using, but what the follow-on question asks is, how satisfied or dissatisfied with you are it. Because we might have a bunch of churches who are using a particular curriculum. Thing is, they all just started using this year. They're all finding that it just doesn't work. They're all very satisfied, and they're going to change. But if we don't ask them what is their satisfaction level with that curriculum, all we're going to see is a lot of churches are using this, and not very many are using another. And that could then lead you to think that this is a particularly good curriculum because a lot of churches use it, when actually a lot of churches are using it and are dissatisfied. So in each of your questions, you need to think through, does this question go far enough, or do we need a second question to make sure that we get all the information about this particular topic? So now here's a screenshot of an online survey tool that we used for our children's ministry survey. We sent it out by email and asked people to come to this website. Down the left-hand side, we listed all the popular curriculums that our churches use, making sure that at the end there was a space for other. We asked them how long they've used it, and then we asked them about the endorsement. Did an EPC endorsement figure significantly, somewhat significantly, or did it not figure in at all? And if it didn't figure in at all, what factor did help you choose the curriculum that you chose? Was it your own research? Was it recommendation of a friend? Was it strictly a pricing thing? So those are the follow-on questions to get you a complete picture about what it is that you're trying to get an analysis of, which for this survey, even though we asked a bunch of questions, most of them had to do with children's ministry curriculum. That was the focus. There are other things that we thought we would ask since we were go ahead and asking questions, but that was the primary focus, was curriculum. Okay, and so we want to use the following questions to help understand people's opinions. Like another example of a follow-on question, we asked people, what has changed most in your ministry in the last 5 years? And that would be good to determine what are the factors that are affecting children's ministry, but we also understand not what are the factors that are affecting, but why are these factors affecting your ministry more than other factors? And so that was the follow-on question. What have been main contributors to these changes? For instance, you've had a lot of growth in your children's ministry. Well, that's great. Is that because you did a better job promoting and asking for volunteers and recruiting them? Is it because you've had a growth in your church and every ministry has grown proportionally? Has there been an economic boom in your community and more people are coming into your church? And that can be harder, trying to figure out a list of possibilities for that follow-on question, but at least, again, getting in that mindset, does this question give us enough information, or do we need to ask another question to get at the detail? So this isn't a formula, unfortunately, I can give you. I'm trying to give you general principles here and get you thinking about these kind of things. Putting together surveys takes a lot of practice. Every time you do a survey, you'll look back at the previous one and go, oh, gosh, we should have done this a little bit differently. It's a learning experience. So now we've talked about survey questions, let's talk about the survey itself, because how you design the survey can also impact the quality of the responses and information that you get. You want to ask as few questions as possible, and I touched on that earlier, because the fewer questions you ask and the simpler you make those questions, the more likely you are to get people to complete your survey. If you hand it out, it's paper, people can see it's 3 pages, but it's all yes-no questions or multiple choice, they're far more likely to fill it out than if they say 3 pages of essay questions. And again, I'm not saying that you should avoid using essay questions, you just want to keep them to a minimum. Because in people's minds, an essay question takes longer to fill out. So showing them multiple choice yes-no questions kind of makes things easier for them. And then, if you're not doing a paper survey, if you're doing something electronic like I showed you earlier, you want to make sure you let people know how many questions, how many sections there are, and how long you think it will take. As a general rule of thumb, what's best is when you put a survey together is ask a couple of people to take the survey and time it and see what they come up with. If you can't get anyone to test your survey for you, or you can only get maybe 2 people and you're not really, you get a great disparity of response there. One person took 8 minutes, another person took 20. The general rule of thumb I use is read through every question and every answer, time yourself. However long it takes you to read all the questions with all the answers, add 50%. And that's what you can tell people they can expect to spend on this survey. So if it takes you 10 minutes to read through your own survey, tell people that it will probably take 15 minutes or less to complete the survey. just as a general rule of thumb. Also, something else you can do is not only thank people at the end for taking your survey, and please remember to do that, but also thank them at the beginning. You know, hi, thank you for taking our survey. We're using the survey for this ministry with the end result being that we want to accomplish this, so your answers will help us achieve our goals. So you're giving people some a sense of ownership in the survey data and helping them, you know, feel significant about how they're spending their time. They're contributing to something. You spell out the time, how many questions there are, really set people's expectations. But again, thanking them both at the front and the end can do a lot for getting you, you know, more complete surveys. In terms of putting your survey together after you've brainstormed all your questions and you've looked at them to see if they're, you know, positively and consistently worded, and they're as simply worded as possible, go through and group questions that are of similar content. Basically, you're going to be putting together an outline for your survey. And if you can, begin each section with an elimination question. And by that I mean, for instance, in our children's ministry survey, we got to a section, you know, do you have a vacation Bible school? Well, if you answer yes, you complete the questions. If you answer no, you're done with that section. There's like four questions you don't have to answer now. And so putting those elimination questions up front makes it faster for people to complete your survey, and therefore more as they complete each section, they get that sense of accomplishment, and the more accomplishment they feel, the more likely they are to continue on to the end and finish the survey. Also, when you're putting your questions together, ask the most important questions first. Now, the most important questions, again, you're going to have to kind of rank them, but most important questions don't usually have to deal with demographics. Like if you ask people to fill in their name and address, or if you ask them what zip code they live in, if you ask them if they're male, female. Now, some of these things can be important, but if you ask a lot of demographic information at the beginning, you kind of dull people's senses with the survey, and then you go back into asking them to, you know, for more important data that they have to think about. If you reverse that by asking the important questions first, you know, they're already geared up to take the survey, so they go through and they do in those answers, and as survey fatigue starts to set in, they can, you know, skip to the end and they'll see, oh, well, at the end I just have to fill in my name and address. I know that stuff. I don't have to think about that. It gives them more impetus to keep going and finishing the survey. So put that stuff first, put the demographics last. And then again, as you go through and sort your questions, you'll end up creating an outline for your survey. Here's a rough outline of the children's ministry survey we did. We started by asking how you define children's ministry, because that was really important to us. We had thoughts, we had guesses about how we thought people would define children's ministry, but we really needed to know for certain for our survey to have any kind of meaning. Then we asked them, you can see, again, our focus was curriculum, so we asked for curriculum about nursery, preschool, elementary, midweek. We wanted information about VBS and catechism that's related and makes sense, but see, we were putting that near the end because the curriculum was what we were more interested in. We asked questions about how you manage security in your children's ministry survey. Again, it's related. It makes sense to ask it, but we put it near the end. And then we ended up with that demographic data. What presbytery is your church in? How big is your church? What's your title? Things like that. Now, drilling down further, how do we define children's ministry? Here's a sample of how we put the questions together. We were real fortunate on our committee to have a subject matter expert, someone who's worked for years in children's ministry, attends a lot of conferences, and reads a lot about that. So we guessed, based on her input, that, you know, these would be the three most popular answers for how churches define children's ministry. But we always left room for the other, just as a, you know, because somebody might define it differently, and we wanted to know that. And also, you could be surprised, you know, you have what you think are the most popular answers and be totally wrong on that. As it turns out, 80% of our respondents answered one or two, and then looking at some of the people who answered other and how they filled that in, that actually brought the total up to 90%, because some of them, instead of birth, they said 2 weeks through fifth grade, which for us, 2 weeks through fifth grade is pretty much the same as birth through fifth grade. So some of those other answers helped fill in and ended up being responses like one and two. And then the same thing, we had, again, subject matter expert who could help us figure out, you know, what are going to be the most popular formats, and we made those our responses or our possible options for answering the question. So in putting your survey together, it's good to have a subject matter expert. And by that, I mean somebody who's really familiar with that ministry or trends in this kind of ministry or is just knowledgeable about the topic. Design, actually looking at the physical layout, make sure you use a typeface that's legible. Something like Comic Sans is really cute for children's, flyers for children's ministry or for singles retreats, but Comic Sans is not very legible, so it's not good for surveys. Use white or high contrast paper. Something like a canary yellow is fine because it's a pastel. Something like goldenrod or purple is not because of very dark colors. The black ink doesn't show up well, so again, you want high contrast. And then if your survey is big enough that you need sections, make sure you use large bold headlines or titles or some kind of graphic or even a big thick black line. Something that denotes one section from another. How to interpret the results. When I took a couple statistics courses and in one of them the professor came into the class, he put his books down, looked at us all before introducing himself or writing anything on the board and said, "This semester we will find out that figures don't lie, but liars can figure." And I thought, wow, this is going to be an interesting semester, and it was, because we spent the whole semester looking at how you can interpret data, how you can skew the results, how you can misinterpret the results. So I've had this work, that's why I feel qualified to bring you this seminar. But I want to let you know that there are people who get an entire degree just in the science of statistics. So I'm giving you just the tip of the iceberg in how to interpret your results here. Basically, I'm going to try to show some things to make sure you don't do to avoid biasing your results. But if you've got someone on, in your church who is a math major who's had statistics work, bring them in and have them help you interpret these results. Okay, first thing we want to look at, and we've touched on this a little bit, is your survey biased? And that is looking at your sample size. Remember, that's the number of surveys that were returned, comparing that to your population, which is the number of surveys you passed out, and looking, are the demographics different? For instance, if your church is pretty much 50-50 men and women, but you get your survey results back and two-thirds of the respondents are women and one-third is men, you've got a biased survey. That doesn't mean it's invalid. It just means the results are skewed toward a woman's perspective in this particular instance. Same thing can be said for age, gender, income levels, location. If you add, if you've got a large church that's across the metropolitan region and you're pulling people from maybe 6 or 7 different zip codes coming to your church, then you need to know that if half your population comes from one zip code and the other half comes from the other 5 zip codes put together, in your survey results you get back, you better have half your results come from one zip code and the other half of however many surveys come back come from a combination of the other zip codes. Otherwise, you have population groups that are either overrepresented or underrepresented. So, and again, this doesn't invalidate your results, it's just that you need to be aware that you might have to go back and do some follow-up questions or just go forward with a particular assumption, knowing that that assumption could be wrong. Now, I'm giving you this is one website I found. There's many others out there. This is a statistical calculator website. What this does is it helps determine the confidence level for your survey. A confidence level basically is a statistical measure to figure out, did you get a large enough sample size to show that you have a valid survey? And so you can put in here either the size of your congregation and the confidence level that you want, and it'll tell you how many surveys you need to get back to reach that confidence level. Or you can put in, here's our population size, here's the number of samples we got back, tell us what confidence level can we have in this. Typically in scientific surveys, you always want to go for like a 95 or 99% confidence level. Those are very hard to achieve unless you have a very large church. So my suggestion would be you want to shoot for a 90% confidence level with a 5% confidence interval. That's often in news reports that's read as, you know, this survey has a confidence level of 95% plus or minus 3%. Okay, 3% is your confidence level. I already went ahead and did some calculations for you, so you don't have to go and do them if you don't want. But basically, as you can see, the larger your population, you don't need a correspondingly larger sample size, because the larger your population, the more likely is this sample of answers is going to be representative of your whole population. For example, if we go from a population in your church of 150 to 300, we double the size. We don't double the sample size. Or I should say, we don't need to double the sample size. So that just says that, you know, as your population increases, as long as your sample size is of a certain size, it's probably going to give you a good idea of how all of your church would have responded had everybody turned in a survey. A good rule of thumb is that anytime you get a response, and I'm thinking here binary answers, the yes, no, true, false things, anytime you get a 2-to-1 ratio or a better than 2-to-1 ratio that people, you know, a certain group says this and only half as many say this over here, you've got a pretty good indication, regardless of your sample size, that that's how your entire church would vote on a particular issue if your entire church had voted. That 2-to-1 ratio. That's just kind of a rule of thumb. That's not a hard, fast rule. We already talked about, do the results vary by demographic? If they do, there's a bias, and you just have to either accept the bias or you know, decide maybe you want to junk the survey if the sample size is very skewed from your population. Okay, and if the results don't yield meaningful answers, I mean, if you have a multiple choice answer, say there's four options that people can answer, and you get pretty much a peanut butter spread of those four answers, they're all answered about the equal amount of, same number of people answered each option, then you have to look at, you know, did we ask the right question? Did we ask it properly? Is there some kind of bias that maybe is affecting this? Did we make assumptions about our population that were incorrect? Or potentially, you know, it's a very true representation, but it's very rare to ask a multiple choice question and get a peanut butter spread of answers, unless the answers are so similar that there really is no distinction between them. Now, a crosstab analysis, I'd mentioned this earlier, crosstab analysis is where you take one variable in your survey and compare it to another. Going back to our example of the food and the lobby. If you do an online survey, or if you want to somehow hand tabulate these into a spreadsheet, you can take a look at all the people who selected particular kinds of food that they would like to see served before the worship service or afterward. And then you can look and compare each of those answers to where they said they would or would not eat that food. That's a crosstab analysis. So you may find out that you get a lot of people who said they would drink coffee, but by doing the crosstab analysis, you'll find out they will only drink it in the fellowship hall. They will not drink it anywhere else for fear of damaging the carpet or whatever, or bumping into somebody, or getting bumped into and having coffee spilled on them. So in our children's ministry survey, we looked at the kind of curriculum the churches were using, and we compared that to church size and by which presbytery the churches were located in, because we wanted to see if there were any trends. And what we found out is that if you look at the trends for the whole survey compared to the trends for each presbytery, the trends were all pretty much the same. So presbytery does not affect curriculum. However, when you take the results, the trends of the overall survey, and you compare them by different brackets of church size, we find out there were variations. So that tells us that church size does affect the curriculum churches select, but there are no regional or presbytery distinctions in the kind of curriculum that churches use. So wrapping up, I know I've gone through a lot of information. It's a lot to absorb, and it involves some math that, you know, some of you might not be too keen on. But what I did is I put together a quick survey of free surveys that I found available. There are many more, but these are the ones I found that don't require banner ads. They had good reviews, and they offer a lot of features for free. I listed them in alphabetical order, although eSurvey Pro Free at the top seems to offer the most bang for the buck. Now, here at the General Assembly office, we use SurveyMonkey, but not Basic. We've paid for that SurveyMonkey service. So I'm very familiar with that. If you select, thinking of selecting that, I can give you some information about that if you have questions. I've not used the basic version, so I can't speak to that, but I'm just saying that's the only survey tool that I'm familiar with, because that's what was selected before I came on board with the EPC. So there's that. We looked at why you would use a survey. Again, it's to answer a specific question, to determine is what you're doing what's needed, or do you need to be doing something else, or doing what you're doing differently. We looked at how to design survey questions, particularly how to be clear and avoid bias. We looked at how to design a survey to improve the response rate that you're going to get back. And we also briefly touched on the topic how to interpret. Now, I'm going to go ahead and start a topic in EPC Community for this particular seminar. So when you get a chance, log into EPC Community. That's at http://epc.socialgo.com. So you can look for the discussion in there. Feel free to join in, make a comment, ask questions. The next few of these recorded seminars that I'm going to put together, the next one will be Know Your Rights and Everyone Else's. We'll be talking about copyright and fair use. What do you need to do to protect your church if it produces copyrighted material? How to make sure you don't infringe on someone else's copyright and potentially open yourself up to some fines? And also, what is fair use? Because it is permissible to use a small amount of someone's work without creating a copyright infringement, and we'll talk about that. I'm also going to repost the Facebook Basics webinar that we did last month. I'll be going through and re-recording that, putting that back up on the YouTube channel instead of Vimeo, and again opening up a discussion topic for that. All of this information plus the slides from this presentation you can find at epc.org on the EPC Communicators webpage. On the front page, if you click Ministries and then click Christian Education and Communications, then you can drill down into this page, which has these slide decks and a bunch of other information. And as always, make sure you send me a picture of your church so I can add it to our Flickr or Pinterest profile.